You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. If you have not watched the show before, this is a live garden show broadcast where we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. You can call in with questions about your garden, about plant materials you're interested in growing, if you've had a problem in your garden with certain plant materials, whatever you want to talk about, give us a call, 1-800-339-1193. You can also email us your questions. And if you have photographs, you can attach them as JPEGs or however you want to attach them. And we'll bring them up. So you can send your email questions to askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Occasionally we get people send us some photographs. We'll bring them up. We'll talk about what's in your photograph. If it's a picture of a tree for identification or disease ID or diagnosis, anything you want us to do, we'll try and do that. We always like to start the show with upcoming events that you can put on your calendar. Get out and enjoy our wonderful fall weather in Southern California. So let's take a look what we have on our calendar for you today. We have the Fall Native Plant Sale. This is at the California State University Dominguez Hills, coming up November 7th, and you'll be able to pick up a lot of native plants, including trees and shrubs and flowers. You can call 310-243-3381 for more information. That's November 7th from 12 to 4:30 in the Biology Department greenhouse. In addition to that, we have plant information with Frank McDonough at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on November 12th from 1:30 to 3. You can call 626-821-4623 for more information. Frank is a very knowledgeable arborist, or I should say horticulturalist, and he usually has these sessions to help the volunteers there at the Arboretum understanding what's going on in the garden, issues that they may be asked about. So it's always an interesting lecture discussing the latest issues in horticulture and botany for home gardeners. In addition to that, we have the Descanso Gardens meet with Nicholas Standen and talk about new varieties of plants for your garden on November 18th from 2 to 3. Give them a call at 818-949-4200 to ask them anything you want to know about this event. And there are a lot of new materials that you can start using in your garden. Certainly we need to move away from our really thirsty plant materials we've been using for many, many decades and start thinking about materials that require little to no irrigation. So that's our last event that you can put on your calendar. But if you are looking for something to do and to learn more about plant materials, we have a lot of botanical gardens, quite a few actually. There's Rancho Santa Ana out in Claremont, the Arboretum in Arcadia, the Huntington Botanical Gardens in San Marino, Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, the Fullerton Arboretum in Fullerton, Cal State Fullerton, San Diego Botanic Garden down in San Diego. They all have classes and lectures, and you can go there and learn a lot more about your plants. A lot of people, if you haven't had a class in horticulture or botany, you're just guessing on how to take care of your garden. You really don't know. You might not know really how to water. You might not know how to prune. You might not know how to fertilize. You might not know the names of your plants, which can be very important in figuring out what's wrong with the plant, if it's the right spot for it to be growing. Maybe it's just the whole wrong part of the world to try and grow a plant, like whatever the problem is. But anyway, rambling, we're going to talk about cycads today. And cycads are kind of an ancient group of plants. They're really very well adapted or do well in Southern California. And they're just a fascinating group. Often referred to as palms, but they're not palms, they're cone-bearing plants. more primitive than the pines, which are also cone-bearing. The term that is used in botany is called a gymnosperm, which means naked seed. And pines are gymnosperms. And you know, usually things that have cones, they're wind-pollinated, and the seed is actually open to the air, as opposed to a flowering plant, the angiosperms, where the seed is not open to the air. It's enclosed in a fruit, or you know, some type of fruit, not necessarily a fleshy fruit, but something that is a fruit. So anyway, we'll talk about cycads here in a minute. There were some really interesting things I saw during the week that I want to share with you. Let's take a look at the first one. I got several things to show you, but let's take a look at this right now. This is a sample that came in from nursery inspection. My day job is with the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner, where I run a plant diagnostic laboratory. And samples come in from our inspectors from shipments from other states. And we're looking for things we don't let into California because we don't want problems. But this is an interesting sample that came in. Let's go to the overhead. And now you can see that these are mango leaves. And when they came in, they had all these spots all over. Now, I left it in the plastic bag for a couple days, and the spots quickly enlarged and encompassed the entire leaf. Now, this is actually what you call anthracnose. And anthracnose is always basically a leaf spot, or in some cases is a fruit spot. There are a handful of fungi that are responsible for causing anthracnose. Usually on a leaf anthracnose on a tree species, it's specific to that tree. So the fungi that cause anthracnose on maples aren't going to necessarily infect oaks, or in this case, this one, which is caused by Calotropicum gliosporoides. Now, Calotropicum typically has a large host range, and it may occur on a wide number of plant species, and whether it's the exact same fungus or not is a good question. But this is anthracnose on mango. It came in, but this is not a regulated disease. It occurs wherever mangoes are grown. So it already occurs in California. So now the plants came in from Georgia, and of course it's very wet in Georgia, and anthracnose diseases are always favored by high rainfall or high humidity and a lot of water on the leaves. So typically anthracnose is not a big problem in California, and mangoes are kind of marginal for Southern California. You can grow mangoes here. They're tender. They can freeze. So you got to be careful growing mangoes, especially the first few years when they're in the ground. You go get a 5-gallon or 15-gallon mango, you put it in the ground. If that year we get a real hard freeze, or if you live in an area where we get harder freezes, say you're in Altadena, Sierra Madre, or La Cañada, or any of the areas that get a little colder, you could easily freeze and kill a small mango tree. If you're lucky and we have several warm winters after you've planted your mango, then it'll get bigger, and then most likely, even if it got a hard freeze, it wouldn't kill the tree, it would just freeze some of the leaves, and it would recover in the spring. They're not much, more sensitive to cold than, say, an avocado. Avocados are tender. The same is true for avocados as for mangoes. If you put in a small one and we get a hard freeze in the winter, it could actually kill the whole plant. And so that means if we get down into the low 20s, so the higher in elevation you are, if you're up against the mountains and we get a hard freeze, you could lose your avocado if it's a new one. So, but anyway, this is anthracnose that occurs on mango. And of course, here in Southern California, this would only be a problem briefly in the spring if we have a very wet spring. Most years, you won't see anthracnose on mango if you're growing one. And of course, mangoes are more appropriate for areas that have very warm winters and rarely freeze. So right along the coast, they'll do quite well. And there's a lot of different varieties of mangoes, and one of my favorite fruits. I love mangoes. I'm not growing one, although I've often thought about it. Now, the next thing I found this week, and this is a little more fun, that was just a little disease, but I am a plant pathologist, so I should get more excited about the diseases, but I'm also a mycologist. And I focus, you know, my expertise is mostly in fungal diseases of plants, and particularly ornamentals and landscape materials, because I've just worked with them for so many years. But I'm, you know, well-versed in many of the diseases in agricultural production as well. But anyways, let's take a look at this, because this is really interesting. Let's go to the overhead. And I thought about having people guess what it is, but I'm just too excited to not tell you. This is a puffball. And it's a little different than most puffballs because a lot of puffballs form a little pore at the tip, an ostiole, and then when you tap it, it puffs spores. This one doesn't do that. This one breaks apart slowly and disintegrates, and this can sit around for years while it slowly disintegrates, and the spores, which are right in here in this crack, if I dig right in here, this is all spores right here. These are all spores, and knocked a little piece down there. But anyway, so if I just tap this, you can see all these spores falling out. And so this puffball, the name of it is Pithelithis tinctorius. And it's such a big mouthful that people just call it PT. And why is it so exciting and so fun? Well, it is ectomycorrhizal, which means it grows in association with the roots of trees, particularly the pine family, the Pinaceae, the beech family, eucalyptus, so oaks, maples. It's north temperate tree species, but you know, eucalyptus aren't north temperate. They're Australian, of course. But eucalyptus are also ectomycorrhizal, and this will grow on eucalyptus. And this is the actual, this is like a mushroom in terms that it's the sexual reproductive structure for the fungus. And this one isn't all that big. I've seen them much, much larger than this, actually the size of a soccer ball. And so this is Pithelithis tinctorius, PT. And the reason it's kind of famous is it became known as the superfungus. Because in the 1960s, a researcher by the name of Don Marks published many, many papers about this fungus when inoculated onto pines and then used to plant into mine tailings because it had been nearly impossible to reforest mine tailings in the Midwest, in Kentucky and Tennessee and places like that. These large open pit mines, and they have literally mountains of mine tailings. And the pH in those mine tailings would be as low as 2, and actually quite warm as well. So very inhospitable soil conditions to replant. And for years, people had just put pines in from pots, and they would die. They wouldn't survive. So Don inoculated his pines with, I should say Dr. Marks, inoculated his pines with this fungus by shaking the spores on the roots or mixing it with the soil, however you want to do it, and then letting the plants, the fungus infect the roots, and then planting them out in the ground, out in the mine tailings. And after he planted his trees, in 7 years, he had what's called canopy closure, which means the pines grew together and the branches were touching each other. So you had canopy closure. So that was very, very successful way to reclaim mine tailings. And before he did it, no one bothered to do it. So he published a lot of papers, like Pithelithis tinctorius stimulates growth of loblolly pine. He had quite a few papers, about 40. And now, when you go out and you buy these mycorrhizal inoculants, and you can buy them now and put them on your plants in your garden, it's not 100% necessary that you do that. Really, mycorrhizae, or these fungi that infect the roots of plants and are beneficial, they're ubiquitous in the soil. They're in the soil. Unless you got rid of them somehow, they're there. There's two groups. There are ones like this one, which are called ectomycorrhizae, that grow on the outside of roots. And there are those that are endomycorrhizal that grow inside the roots. The ones that are endomycorrhizal, you're not going to see their sexual reproductive structures. You're not going to see big fleshy fruiting bodies like mushrooms or puffballs, things like that, because their spores are microscopic and are made either in the root or just outside the root, and they're in the soil. So you're not going to see them. The ectomycorrhizae, which is the smaller group, endomycorrhizae is the larger group by far, because almost everything is endomycorrhizal, such as all the fruit trees, you know, citrus and the stone fruits, you know, plums and peaches and that kind of thing. All the vegetables, grasses are all endomycorrhizal. So most plants are endomycorrhizal. It's just a small group, about 10% of the plants on Earth are ectomycorrhizal, and those are mostly, as I said, north temperate tree species. But now you can go out and you can buy these mycorrhizae as inoculants. You can buy it just as a pure inoculant with just the spores. usually mixed. Actually, these are what we call obligate. They have to grow on a living host. It's very difficult just to grow them, or really impossible for most species, to grow them on some type of media, grow them on straw or something like that. That's not how they grow. They have to grow attached to a root. So typically for the endomycorrhizal species, they grow them on the roots of grasses. Then they just take in, you know, the roots and they chop them up, and that's your inoculum. Now, you can get a lot of fertilizers that are mixed with mycorrhizae, such as Dr. Earth, Grow Power has one. There's one called BioStar. There's many. And typically it's a low nitrogen fertilizer, maybe 3% up to maybe 7% nitrogen, not very strong in terms of nitrogen percentage. And then they're mixed with a wide variety of different mycorrhizal fungi. And this one is almost always in the mix. PT, or Pitholithus tinctorius, is almost always one of the fungi in the mix. They'll also throw in a handful of species within the genus Glomus. So Glomus erratices, Glomus deserticula, and there's a whole bunch of, and Glomus are endomycorrhizal. You'll also see often some other ectomycorrhizal species in the mixture as well. The idea is you can take that product and put it on any plant, and there's something in there that will infect the roots of whatever you're trying to treat. So I found this in a garden in Covina, where the homeowner had been mixing in mycorrhizae into her holes whenever she planted. And then this came up in her garden, and she didn't really know what it was. At first she thought it might be a pathogen. It's not a pathogen. This is a beneficial fungus. This is great to find. I often see them growing in Christmas tree nurseries. When you're walking down the rows of these Christmas trees, you'll find these fruiting on the surface of the soil. Now this part is underground, right here. This part is underground, and this part will stick up. It's also known as, dead man's foot. Because usually when you find them, you know, this can persist in the environment for many years. It's, oh, I crushed that part. I didn't want to break it up too much. Oops. But anyway, now you can see the spore mass. It's a lot of spores. There's probably literally billions and billions of spores in here. And in fact, you can just take this and shake it into the soil and mix it with soil. And if you're going to plant something out like an oak or maybe a pine, then you'll just guarantee that it's going to be infected early and do quite well. And in fact, if you inoculate this onto pines before they get infected with Phytophthora, and Phytophthora is a water mold that causes root rot on most hosts, and there's about 100 species of Phytophthora, you can actually prevent Phytophthora infection by inoculating in advance in nursery production, because ectomycorrhizae have this sheath that covers the root and prevents, it's a physical barrier that actually prevents it from the fungi from actually getting. And that's why they call it ectomycorrhizal. It's not growing deep in the root. It infects just the outer surface of the root and then covers the root in a sheath. And actually changes the morphology of the root. The root becomes stunted and small, and the fungus grows out these microscopic filaments or hyphae. Then they grow out into the soil, and they have this tremendous surface area, and they absorb a lot of things that are very hard for plants to absorb, such as zinc, perhaps iron, but really they can probably absorb all the nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, zinc, magnesium, manganese, copper, all those things that the fungi are much better at absorbing than the plant. And in fact, some plants are extremely dependent on their mycorrhizal partners. So like grape, if you try and grow grape in a sterilized soil, it will be bright yellow. It will be extremely zinc deficient and it'll be bright yellow. So it'll probably be also phosphorus deficient as well, because that's another one that can be a little more difficult for plants to absorb. Citrus are highly dependent on their mycorrhizal partners, as opposed to something like avocado, which doesn't seem to be as dependent on its mycorrhizal partner. And if you grow it in a sterilized soil, you might not really notice it. You can, of course, add those elements as fertilizers, but it's always nice to let nature take its course. But you can add these inoculants. And in fact, often on trees that are in decline and doing very poorly, it's about the only thing you can try to revitalize or have a tree recover from whatever's causing decline. So a lot of times people have oaks, coast live oak or whatever native oak you have, and they're doing quite poorly. They're thinning, there's poor growth, it looks like it might die. Well, you can drill holes in the soil, put these fertilizer and mycorrhizal mixes in the holes, and hopefully that will stimulate a lot of new root growth within the tree recovers. And I've seen oaks recover when inoculated, so it actually works. You also have to start taking care of the oak properly. So our next item that I'm going to show you, and I'm going to get a new white piece of paper, is going to be a mystery item. I'm going to show it to you, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about it. But let's go to the overhead, and this will be our mystery item today. And you can call in and take a guess if you think you know what this is. It's not very big. Let's go to the overhead, and I'll show it to you. Here it is. This is not very big. I don't know if we can get it any closer, because you might want to get a little closer to get a good light. It has these like ribs. This was actually sent in by a homeowner, and it was attached to the branch in a citrus tree, and they wondered what the heck this is. So if you know what this is, give us a call. Now, all you have to do is kind of barely know what it is. It's really interesting. You can actually buy these and put them out in your garden. That's all that I'm going to give you for a tip right now. So here it is. Let me see. Let me just hold it like this and kind of turn it around a little bit. And this is the part that was on the branch. And this is really, there's the top of it. But it's kind of ribbed. And they're really cool. So if you know what that is, give us a call and take a guess. 1-800-339-1193. There's our mystery object for the day. And once you find out what it is, you'll want to get one for your garden too. One last item to show you before we move on to our lecture is this little mushroom. We do have a lecture on mushrooms coming up where I'll talk more in depth about mushrooms, but I always like, anytime I find a mushroom, to bring them in. So there's a couple things to notice on this. One, just to remind you what the things you need to observe if you want to identify mushrooms. And I brought in last week David Arora's Mushroom Demystified. It was a really good key. But this right here is called the partial veil. This is the ring or the annulus that you find on the stipe after this opens up all the way. But this is called the partial veil. The universal veil would attach from the base all the way around it to here. And of course, it breaks as the mushroom pushes up through. This one has no universal veil. So that's interesting because that means that it can't be an Amanita. And if we just slice through it, maybe we'll see if there's any staining. Oh, that broke off pretty easily there. I didn't mean to do that. But let's cut through it and take a look. So it is a gilled mushroom. You can see the gills. They're white right now. But I wonder, because this is a very young one. This is a very young mushroom. There are the gills. Whoop, went the wrong way. Here we go. There are the gills right in here. And this is very young, so I wonder if this is the mature color of the gills. This was the only one I found this morning. But I suspect that this may be either an agaricus or a lepiota. And if these gills were to stay white and had a white spore print, it would probably be a lepiota. If they turn dark and the spore print is chocolate brown, then it's going to be an agaricus. But anyway, this is a fun little mushroom. One of the things you always want to see is, does it stain when I scrape it? And it's not staining. See, it's not changing color when you scrape it or do anything. It's just staying white. The stem is stuffed. It's solid. It's not really hollow. All these things you take into account when you're identifying mushrooms. Growing in a lawn, growing in the fall, young with white gills, and if at maturity it retained those white gills and had a white spore print, almost certainly be in the genus Lepiota. And most of the Lepiotas are edible. Lepiotas are the parasol mushrooms, and the Lepiota ricoides is the one that some people get sick to their stomach if they eat. Lepiota persea is the parasol mushroom, which is one of the choice edibles and wild mushrooms that people look for. So, now today we're going to talk about cycads. So let's move on to cycads. I've got a couple books on cycads. I showed you this book last week, actually, because it's palms and cycads. And so this covers both palms and cycads. And most people who are into palms are also into cycads because they're very similar in their outward appearance. So this is Palms and Cycads, Beyond the Tropics, a really nice book. And then this one is Cycads of Central Africa, And there's a lot of good books on SciCats you can get. If you want to read more about the group and understand them a little better and maybe pick a species or two to grow in your garden. So let's talk about cycads. And you can see these cycads behind me. And cycads are seed-bearing plants, as opposed to something like a fern, which does not have seeds, and typically characterized by a stout and woody trunk with a crown of large, hard, and stiff evergreen leaves. Now, that description also fits a palm tree. But palm trees are flowering plants, and these are not flowering plants. These are gymnosperms. They make cones, and they are actually quite primitive. They vary in size from having a trunk that is only a few centimeters tall to trunks up to several meters tall, so they can be small trees. The individual plants are either male or female. So you have male cones and you have female cones, and they occur on different plants. If a plant has a female cone, it's never going to produce a male cone, and the males never produce a female cone. On pine trees, often you get both cones, male and female cones, on the same tree. Typically, the male cones are at the bottom of the tree, and the female cones are at the top of the tree. And what that does is facilitate outcrossing. So the pollen made in the male cones floats off in the air, but doesn't get to the top of the tree. And pollen from other trees gets to the top of the tree to pollinate the female cones, and so you get outcrossing and you don't get selfing. And as I said, because of the superficial resemblance, these cycads are often confused with and mistaken for palms or ferns. They grow very slowly and live very long, with some specimens known to be as much as 1,000 years old. And in fact, they grow very slowly. So if you want to grow these, you have to have a lot of patience. They are found across much of the subtropical and tropical parts of the world. Most cycads are tender and will freeze if we get cold enough. So you can't grow them in Montana or the Dakotas or Canada, but they do quite well in Southern California. They are found in South and Central America, where their greatest diversity occurs. Mexico, the Antilles, southeastern United States, there is a native species in Florida. They are native to Australia, Melanesia, Micronesia, Japan, China, Southeast Asia, India, Sri Lanka, Madagascar, and southern and tropical Africa, where at least 65 species are known from Africa. Some can survive in harsh semi-desert climates, others in wet rainforest conditions, and some in both. Cycads belong to the division Cycadophyta. Sorry, I couldn't pronounce that properly. There are three families of the cycads currently. There are some extinct families, but there's the Cycadaceae, which has cycas as the main genus. The Stagaraceae and the Zamiaceae. Though they are minor component of the plant kingdom today, during the Jurassic period, they were extremely common. And in fact, many of our coal and oil deposits are actually from cycads. So, but they were around, you know, a long time ago, and now what we have really is a remnant of what was once cycad forests that covered most of the earth. They have changed very little since the Jurassic compared to some major evolutionary changes in other plants. So a lot of people call them living fossils. They're not really, they're descendants. They're still descendants. They just retain most of the characteristics of their ancestors. As I said, they're gymnosperms. And they have very specialized pollinators, usually beetles. And so in Southern California, we don't have those beetles. And typically, you will not get viable seed off of your cycads unless you hand pollinate them. And in fact, you've got to do that just at the right moment if you want to get viable seed. The females will produce the seed, but it's not pollinated, so there's no embryo inside and it doesn't grow a new plant. I used to collect a lot of seed at various times and put them in trays and wait, and they never germinate. The cycad fossil record dates to the early Permian, 280 million years ago. So they are ancient. It's an ancient group of plants. Recent studies have indicated that the common perception of existing cycad species as living fossils as I said, it's misplaced. They are, the species we have today didn't exist 280 million years ago. They are still, but they are descendants of those species. And so in a way, they are living fossils. The family Stangoraceae consists of only three species, is thought to be of Guandanan origin. Guandana was the large continental mass that broke into, I guess, Asia and North America and South America. That was all one giant landmass at one point in the history of Earth. And fossils have been found in the lower Cretaceous deposits in Argentina dating to 70 to 135 million years ago. The family Zamiaceae is more diverse, with fossil record extending from the middle Triassic to the Eocene. That's 54 to 200 billion years ago in North and South America, Europe, Australia, and Antarctica, implying that the family was present before the breakup of Pangaea. The family Cycadaceae is thought to be an early offshoot from the other cycads, with fossils from Eocene deposits 54 million years ago in Japan and China, indicating that this family originated in Laurasia. Cycas is the only genus in the family and contains 99 species, the most of any cycad genus. And Cycas is the most common, Cycas revoluta, and we'll take a look at that. I showed you a Cycas revoluta last week. That is the most common cycad you see grown in Southern California, is the sago palm. It is not a palm, it is a cycad, but it's called, the actual name is Cycas revoluta. Historically, cycads have been used as food source, as this is especially true in what is today we call Florida, where the Seminole Indians extracted a starch from the roots and stems of the native cycad, Zamia floridiana, and prepared sofki, a pudding that was a staple of every Seminole meal. Later, it was used as a substitute for scarce wheat flour, and the Indians came to refer to the cycad as the white bread plant. Non-native settlers found around Miami established the area's earliest industry based on this starch, referred to as arrowroot, cornstarch, or locally as kuntai. That persisted up until the 1920s. Preparing the arrowroot cornstarch involved peeling, grating, and grinding the cycad stems and roots into a flour. The flour then had to be washed to remove cycasin, a water-soluble toxin. Unfortunately, this last step was overlooked by Confederate soldiers stationed in Florida during the Civil War, and the result was many fatalities. So it's not unlike a lot of other things that Native peoples have eaten in North America. You have to leach out things that are toxic. You know, our Native American Indians, our Native Indians in the Southern California used to make a meal out of acorns, but the acorns had to be leached in order to be edible. A cycad, let's take a look at some cycads. We had that picture behind me, and that's number one. Bring it up full screen and I'll point out a few things. These are cycas, and they may be cycas revoluta, sago palms, or maybe that's an encephalartos. It's hard to say from this picture, but this is typically what they look like. Our next picture shows the distribution of cycads, and you'll see they really come from warm areas of the earth. So they come from the northern South America and Central America, and a little bit from Florida right in here, from tropical Africa, and then these tropical areas in Asia, and then also Australia. So you can see that they don't really occur, or will they survive, in areas where it freezes and you have long, cold winters. Our next picture is Bowinia cerealata. And before we move on, let's move on to our next picture real quick, and we'll come back to this Bowinia. This next one is number four, and this is the fossil cycad, and this was actually collected. Let's see, where is this from? It's actually from Carlsbad, California, and I have some notes, and I guess we'll get back to that in a minute. This is one of the fossils of cycads, and this was actually collected in California down in Carlsbad. So we talked about Zamiaceae, Cycadaceae, that they used them for food. And yeah, this cycad leaf impression behind me from Carlsbad, California, was discovered in the 75-million-year-old Point Loma Formation of coastal San Diego County. So very interesting that we actually have cycad fossils in California that are millions and millions of years old. So let's talk a little bit more about the taxonomy of cycads. There are about 350 described species in those three families that we talked about, in 10 to 12 genera, and three families. Now, some people argue there may only be two families, but that's splitting hairs. So the Cycadaceae has about 105 species in the Old World from Africa east to southern Japan, Australia, and the western Pacific Ocean islands. There's a Cycas circinalis, Cycas prunosa, and Cycas revoluta. And let me just, let's see what we want to go to first. Let's go to our number five and show you Cycas revoluta female cone. This is the female cone from Cycas revoluta. And these big red seeds or orange seeds in here. And as I said, you'll see these on these sago palms, but they're almost certainly not going to germinate and produce a plant. And then I have one here. And one of the things that Cycas does, let's come back to me and I'll show you this plant. It's in a 5-gallon pot. This is actually, I cut this off as a pup. Cycas revoluta produces offshoots at the base. It clumps. And you can cut those off and pot them up and grow them. And it's not that hard to grow them. And this came off of one in my backyard. It's getting to be a bigger plant now. And it's starting to throw pups off the base or, you know, little plants. And you cut it off and pot it up. And look how big this one has gotten. So this is Cycas revoluta, the sago palm that I grew from a little pup off of a big plant in my yard. Now you can leave them on there and you'll get a big clump. And that's the female cone for Cycas revoluta behind me. And the next one also shows the female cone. Let's look at our next picture, number six. And again, and this is Cycas revoluta. And there are the seeds in there. Now you can't really collect these. Now this will kind of all peel back like this and new leaves will come up right through here. So often what you'll see is the remnants of these are bracts. And you'll see these down lower among the leaves after they bloom. And let's take a look at number seven and take a look at the Cycas leaves. I mean, Cycas revoluta, the seed. So you can see these, they're quite large. They're usually about an inch or two across. But if you don't hand pollinate, you're not gonna get any viable seed. And the next picture is Cycas revoluta male cones, number eight. So here's a male cone. And if you collect this at the right time and get the pollen out of here and then save it, then you can mix it with water and pour it on the female cone. And that's actually how you do it. And I'm not exactly sure. You have to do it at the right time of year. And let's take a look at our next one, number 10. That's another male cone right there. That's a Cycas revoluta male cone. Now you can see this is the old female cone here, and this is the new leaves pushing up through. A lot of people like to come and prune off all the old leaves when this starts, and I don't do that. I do remove these as they yellow and age, but I don't like to be removing a lot of green leaves. I know it's not good for trees, and I assume it's not good for cycads as well. Let's take a look at our next picture, number 11, which is another Cycas revoluta. And just so you can see, they get quite a bit larger. This is at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, and that's Cycas revoluta, sago palm. Okay, so that shows you a lot of the Cycas. Let's go back to number three and look at Bowinia. Bowinia is in a different family and is really quite different than a lot of cycads for a couple reasons. Stangaria is one species in South Africa. Stangaria is the genus, and it's in the Stangariaceae. And Bowinia is also in the Stangariaceae. So they are from Southern Africa. It is a sole species. There's only one species of Stangaria, Stangaria areopus, and it is from South Africa. And it is closely related to Australian genus Bowinia, which it forms a family. So this one, bring this up full screen. This is the other genus within the Stangariaceae, within the cycads. And you can see that this is bipinnately compound, or even more than that, actually, because here's the main stem. This whole thing is a leaf. This whole thing is kind of a leaf. And then it divides here, and then it divides like this. So most of them are pinnately compound, and this one is actually at least bipinnately compound, and very few, or this may be the only cycad that's bipinnately compound. So let's see here, Bowinia, the two species in Queensland, Bowinia spectabilis, and that's what we're looking at here. This picture behind me is Bowinia spectabilis. Actually, I have it as Cerulata. Two living and two fossil species of cycads, sometimes placed in their own family, the Bowiniaceae. They are entirely restricted to Australia. The two living species occur in Queensland, where they grow in warm, wet, tropical rainforests on protected slopes near streams, primarily in the lowlands. Now, at this time, I'd like to go to a video clip from one of the best cycad nurseries that I've ever seen, and it's local. It's in North Hollywood. And it's A&A Cycads, and Maurice Levins is the nurseryman, or the horticulturalist, who owns and runs the nursery. So let's go to this video clip with Maurice talking about cycads and how he grows them and what they really are.
Although the term living fossil is not usually a compliment when directed at you or me, it is a thing of beauty when it refers to the magnificent cycad. Cycads have remained unchanged for over 300 million years, and a single plant can live for more than 1,000 years. Like most survivors, they are well adapted to hardship. They need little water, few nutrients, and can tolerate everything from intense desert heat to damp rainforests.
These are plants that have survived the ice ages, comets hitting the earth, rampaging dinosaurs. They have these fabulous coralloid roots that allow them to breathe nitrogen from the atmosphere, so they were able to survive on Earth when little else was able to. And the neat thing, you put one of these in your backyard and you are part of a worldwide endangered species preservation movement.
Cycads have necessarily adapted to environments where nothing else can survive. Being slow growers, they've been crowded out of their choice digs by plants that are more aggressive. This makes them rare and so valuable that they are often torn from the forest or stolen from collectors. In turn, connoisseurs pay big bucks for even the smallest seedlings. But Maurice is trying to change all that.
Here's the whole idea. We believe in preservation through propagation. The more we do with growing, pollinating, and propagating, and getting seeds and plants and seedlings into people's gardens, the more we're doing to preserve the species.
Cycads may look like palms, but they are genetically closer to pine trees, and they reproduce by cones. But it's all in the timing.
Now, the neat thing that we've been able to do is work with a number of botanical gardens and private growers who have these mature plants and match up male cones that have pollen with female cones that have seed. And what happens is if you work hard and you time it just right, you can produce these massive Encephalardos cones. And this happens to be the seed of an Encephalardos altensteinii, also known as the Eastern Cape Giant.
That is one giant seed. To test for viability, Maurice floats the seeds, both with the pulp and without. Seeds that sink have a greater likelihood of sprouting. Maurice tucks these babies into a bed of perlite, where they stay snuggled up for 6 to 12 months.
Some of the seeds here have actually germinated, and this is where we get excited, because now you see a new endangered species life that's come out of this little embryonic package here.
That's one radical root! Maurice uses a sterilizing mixture of rooting hormone and fungicide to get things off to a good start.
Cycads have grown for hundreds of millions of years in Africa, so they are very comfortable with the pathogens in the soils of Africa, not so with our soils and water. So what we try to do is every step along the way sterilize them.
Check out how Maurice nestles the seed on top of the soil mix. This mimics how cycads grow in nature, and Mother Nature knows best. Fast forward 6 months, a few more years, a few more, and in 10 years, timeless beauty. Thinking something this rare must be difficult to grow? Remember, cycads have survived everything from volcanoes to droughts.
They are really xerophytic. They can really handle very low water usage, so they're very environmentally friendly. These things have subsisted on the botanical equivalent of bread and water for hundreds of millions of years. You can bet that in your garden they're going to be happy. Just make sure you don't overwater them.
There are only about 300 species of cycads that we know of, but they are amazingly varied. If you're thinking about making the Jurassic leap into owning a living fossil, a great place to start is with a sago palm. Sagos are readily available, tolerant of climate variations, and grow fairly rapidly. And Maurice has a few other suggestions.
Let's talk about plants that are readily available and not that expensive. Diune spinulosum, the spiny leaf cycad from Mexico. Diune palmasola has a slightly recurved and slightly V-shaped leaf. There's a wonderful shade-tolerant plant from Australia called Lepidosamia perovskiana. Oh, I forgot the best one. Encephalardus lehmannii, Lehmann's cycad. It's called the Karoo Desert cycad. It and Encephalardus altensteinii, the Eastern Cape giant, are the two best growing plants for California.
The rarest cycad, and possibly the rarest plant in the entire world, is the Encephalardus woodii. Every existing woodii has been propagated from a single plant, the only one ever discovered in the wild. Besides propagating from seed, Maurice has another solution.
This plant, with its offsets and everything, can be a rather expensive proposition for a collector to acquire. So we're going to show you how we can divide up a Diune capitoi. We're going to cut very carefully and see if we can strike an offset here.
Continually using a fungicide mixture avoids contaminating the new offset.
This plant has its own taproot, so guess what? We're going to try and rescue the little taproot that came along with this plant. Yes, a wonderful little plantlet here that has its own taproot.
A quick dip in some fungicide rooting hormone, a few months in some perlite, a transfer into a larger pot, and there you have it. One more endangered species a step closer to eternal salvation.
So there you go. ANA Cycads is in North Hollywood. You have to call up and get an appointment because they're not open to the public really all day long. It's not like a normal nursery in a way. So you always want to, you know, look them up on the internet, ANA Cycads, and you can buy really nice ones. If you're looking for just a Cycas revoluta, a sago palm, you can get them in almost any nursery, Home Depot, Lowe's, Osh, any garden center or local nursery. They're very common. I remember back when I was at the Huntington, you could get seeds for a dollar a piece. Fairly expensive for seed in a way, because seeds are usually, you know, for a few dollars you get hundreds or hundreds of seeds, depending on the seed you're buying, of course. But in the case of cycads, you could get these seeds that were guaranteed to germinate for Cycas revoluta for about a dollar a piece. And like I said, if you just collect them off a plant that's growing in a landscape, they're not likely to grow at all. So let's move on and talk about, we talked about Bohinia, and we looked at that picture. And now let's see here. Let's take a look at some more revoluta. Let's look at number 12. You know, as they grow, they develop a pretty long trunk, and they're often sold by how tall the trunk is. So take a look at this plant. And if you were, this is a Cycas revoluta. It's developed two heads, which they do occasionally, like this. And if you were to buy that in a pot, it would be at least $1,000 and perhaps a couple thousand dollars. They're not cheap when you buy large plants. But they don't, you know, the Cycas revolutas don't grow that slow. So I would definitely get smaller plants, 5 gallons. And, you know, still you're going to pay, you know, 25 to 50 bucks maybe for one of those. So now the next picture are Cycas pupin roots. And I want to show you something about this in this next picture. And bring, let's see if we can get number 13 up and bring this up full screen. There's a couple things to notice. One is these little pups that, or these offsets that come up at the base of the plant. And once these get a little, you know, you can actually get it off at that size, or you can let it get a little bigger with a few more leaves. And then you reach in here and cut it off and you pot that up and it'll grow. But if you look at this, you see all the bumps on these leaves, on these roots, I mean. These are nodules where the roots are actually fixing nitrogen from the air. And, you know, pea plants do that with rhizobia. You know, the pea family, rhizobia, makes nodules on the roots. This isn't rhizobia. It's probably a actinomycete, some other type of bacteria that's actually fixing nitrogen from the air and making nitrogen available to the plant, because nitrogen in the air is not a usable form for plants, it's N2. And you need things like nitrate or ammonium as a nitrogen source for plants to use. So let's take a look at our next group, and let's actually take a look at a couple more pictures. Cycas revoluta number 14. Here's one that's actually, this is Cycas circinalis female cone. So circinalis is another species within the Cycas genus. This is the female cone. And if we look at our next number 16, this is Cycas circinalis, the male cone. And so here's a new male cone and here's an old male cone. And you gotta really know what you're doing in a way to get the pollen out of here and put it on the female cone. And that means you gotta have a male plant and a female plant. And now if we look at number 17, this is Cycas circinalis with the male cone, the female cone, and then the seed that's produced if you get it pollinated. And then our next one is just a regular cycas. Let's take a look at that. This one's also at the Huntington. This is one of the cycas species. It doesn't really look like Cycas revoluta. I'm not sure which cycas it is. Now let's talk about the Zamiaceae. The Zamiaceae, there are about, well, there's a couple of genera within the family. There's Dion, and there's Encephalartos. Dion, there are 13 species in Mexico and Central America. The type species is Dion edulis. I have one at home. It's gotten big, so I can't bring it in. It's too big a plant now. There are, well, either 11 or 13 accepted species, depending on what expert you talk to. They are from Mexico, Honduras, and Nicaragua. Their habitats include tropical forests, pine oak forests, and dry hillsides, canyons, and coastal dunes. And let's take a look at number 20, and you'll see a picture of Dion edulis. Bring that up full screen. And here's the female cone, so this is a female plant. It's a finer textured leaf compared to Cycas revoluta. And if you take a look at our next picture, which is, our next one is Encephalarta ferox, the female cone. Let's talk about Encephalartos. There are about 66 species in Southeast Africa. So all of the Encephalartos are native to Africa. Several species of Encephalartos are commonly referred to as bread palms, bread tree, or kefir bread. Since a bread-like starchy food can be prepared from the center of the stem, all species of Encephalartos are endangered. And so this is an Encephalartos. Now, the way I kind of recognize Encephalartos is these leaflets. So this is once pinnate. Here's the stem, and these are the leaflets. And these are very stiff with spines on the very edges. And if you brush up against it, these will scratch the heck out of you when you work on these plants. That's a female cone, of course. And if we take a look at our next picture, let's see if we have 22 Encephalartos scalovii. And this is another female cone. And take a look at 23, which are some more Encephalartos. They're a little coarser textured compared to, so if you have Dion, they're kind of fine textured. The Cycas, like Cycas revoluta, is kind of medium textured, and the Encephalartos are very coarsely textured. So these are also at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, and these are quite large. And of course, if you wanted to buy something like that, it would be very expensive. Now, the next one we want to talk about is Macrozamia. Actually, let's take a look at our next picture, which is Encephalartos woodyi. And this is the species that is only known, has been propagated from one plant, and unfortunately it's male. There's no females known. And so you can't get seed because you have no females. And so everything is just offshoots from this plant. I'd imagine it's probably the most difficult plant in the world to purchase or obtain. Let's take a look at number 25, Encephalartos bomboensis is our next species of Encephalartos to look at. These are the seeds from the female cone. And again, you can see, if you take a look at these leaves, they're very stiff. and they've got little spines on the edges. And I show you one here in a minute. It'll take a look at our next picture, 26, which is Encephalartos, another Encephalartos, and these are the male cones. And this is probably pollen down here that's collecting. Now our next species is Macrozamia, and there are about 41 species of Macrozamia in Australia. And they are endemic to Australia, so they occur only in Australia. The majority of the species occur in eastern Australia, in southwest Queensland and New South Wales, with one species in the McDonnell ranges of Northern Territory and three in southern western Australia. And if we bring up this picture, this is Macrozamia communis. And Macrozamias have a much finer texture as well compared to some of the ones we've already looked at. They don't have those stiff spines. You know, they have long, thin leaflets, not these kind of short ones that do this kind of thing like you see on Encephalartos. And of course, this is in the Zamiaceae. Okay, let's take a look here. So let's take a look at our next one, which is, let's see what we've got here, Leptozamia. There are two species in eastern Australia, and they're native to Australia. The name derived from the Greek word leptos, meaning scaly, refers to the scale-like structure of the stem and leaf bases. Native to rainforests. Bring this up full screen. This is 28, I guess. This is Leptozamia profoscia. And so where are they from? They're from Queensland and eastern New South Wales. They have a chromosome number of 2N equals 18. So our next one we want to look at is Ceratozamia. And this is, there are 26 species in southern Mexico and Central America. The type species for the genus is Ceratozamia mexicana. And Ceratozamia is from the New World. 16 to 18 currently living species and one or two fossil species. Most species are endemic to the mountainous areas of Mexico. Ceratozamia robusta extends into the mountains of Guatemala and Belize. Now, so before I finish up on the cycads, we want to take a little station break coming up here. We're going to take just a short break. And when we come back, we'll take a look at how to transplant a large cycad. Actually, they're not that hard to move, other than that they're big and heavy. They take movement. You can dig them up and move them fairly easily. And that's good if you want to move them, but bad if you don't want someone to steal them out of your front yard. Many years ago, I had two sago palms in my front yard out in Riverside when I lived in Riverside. I got up one morning and there was a hole in the ground where one of them had been. Somebody had come in the middle of the night and literally dug it up and stole it. So I went ahead and dug up the other one and moved it to the backyard. Many years ago, now the UCLA Botanic Garden had a large collection of cycads. And somebody at some point in time, I don't know how long ago this was, probably maybe 10 years ago or longer, drove a truck through the fence in the middle of the night and dug up some of their some of the rarest species they had in their collection. And you can dig them up and throw them in the back of the truck. And they stole quite a few of them. The Huntington has a pretty good collection of cycads. It's not going to be so easy to steal them there because they've got a really excellent security because they've also got the library and the art galleries, and so they have extensive security. Now, the Arboretum has some, not a really extensive collection, but a nice collection. Like I said, they are extremely drought tolerant. But let's go to our station break. And when we get back, we'll talk more about cycads and see if there's any calls from the public. Remember, this is a live broadcast and you can call in with questions about your gardens, Gardens of California. So let's go to our station break and I'll be right back with you.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. have to want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
You are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
Hi, my name is Mar Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
I'm Timothy Hudson, a member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live, interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and this is the live garden show where we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. And if you have a question about your garden, give us a call, and hopefully I can answer your question. If you've had particularly if you had a problem in your garden, because that's kind of my expertise. I'm a plant pathologist and an arborist and an agricultural pest control advisor, so I know a lot about diseases and pests, insect pests, mite pests, vertebrate pests, weeds, all that kind of thing. Plant diseases, unfortunately, we have some important plant diseases that are really serious threats to our urban forest. So if you had a problem with a tree, give me a call. Maybe I can answer your questions about that. 1-800-339-1193. We're talking about cycads today. Cycads are really wonderful plant material for Southern California. They're not natives, but they're extremely drought tolerant. So if you put in a cycad, a sago palm or an encephalartos or a dione or one of the really, there's also the zamias. I have a zamia furfuraceae at home as well. I have a dione edulis at home. I have an encephalartos right here that I'm going to show you in a second. These need very little water. So how often are you going to water something like that? Well, the first year after you plant it, I would probably water it as I water every new woody material, like a small tree or a shrub or even a large tree. I water them once a week for about the first year. Once they start to grow and get established, you're going to start watering these guys about once a month. And then if they're really old plantings, you might not really need to water it at all unless we have a dry winter. Like an oak, like a native oak. Generally speaking, native oaks don't need to be watered in the landscape. Unless we have a dry winter, like we did the last two winters. We've had record dry winters, where, of course, everyone knows we're in the grip of a terrible drought. So how often should you water one of these cycads? Well, if we had a regular winter, I might water them a little bit in the spring. I might water them once in March. I'll give them a good deep soak, 2 to 3 inches of water. Not water them in April, skip April. Maybe water them in May, skip June. Maybe then skip the whole summer, or they will do better in the landscape if they are periodically deep drenched. But they don't need to be watered once a month, like you might do to large shade trees that come from areas where they get a lot of rain, like the southern magnolia, which comes from the southern United States, Magnolia grandiflora. I would deep water that once a month, all spring and all summer, because they come from an area that it's used to getting water all summer. So they actually do much better if they get ample water. Something like a cycad, though, I would only water every other month, maybe in the spring, and then I'd very likely, maybe not water at all in the summer. But if I wanted to grow a little better, you can continue soaking once a month in the summer. In drought years, let it go all summer. Keep your water bill down. Save water. That's what these plants will let you do. In wet years, where we don't have a drought problem, you could water them once a month in July, August, September, just to get better growth. Now I have another plant here. Let's take a quick look at them. In a clay pot, so it's a little heavy. This is an encephalartos, and I'm going to spin them around and try not to scratch up the table too much. And this is a gift to me from a graduate student and a colleague of mine. And I've lost the species name, but if I don't know if we can get in close, but it shows one of the real characteristics of encephalartos. First, the leaves are quite stiff, and they've got these little spines on them, and they really scratch you up. Now, what you'll be surprised is I've had this plant for at least 10 years, and it's only grown a handful of leaves on those 10 years. Now, let's see if I can turn this a little bit and show you some of these spines. Well, we almost had it there. Let's go back to that camera because there it is. You can see that the leaves have these little spines on the very edges, and they're quite stiff, and they'll scratch you up real good. So when you're working on these guys, there you can see the little spines right on. Let's see if I can find that leaf. Keep looking for the leaf. Where is it? It's hard to tell where that camera is. But anyway, you can see the spines on the edge of these leaves. And that's kind of characteristic for encephalartos. But of course, the cone is really going to tell you what the cone and the male and the female cones will really indicate what species you've got. But so when you buy them, try not to lose the tag or tag them some way so you don't forget the species. I have had this for quite a few years, and it's really slow growing. part of it is that I haven't watered it much. I often forget to water it, or I intentionally don't water it because I'm trying to save water. So let's talk a little bit more about, we were talking about a leptozamia. We looked at leptozamia and ceratozamia. We didn't look at Microcycus. Microcycus, there's one species of Microcycus native to Cuba, Microcycus calicoma. And let's bring this up, number 30 is Microcycus calicoma. Bring that up full screen. This is a full-size mature one, of course, and if you were to ever be able to buy something like this, I would just get, I couldn't even guess how much you'd have to pay for it. But, you know, this is why people think they're palm trees, or think when they see them in the landscape that they're palms. But this is actually a cycad, and of course you'll be able to know when it produces the cone. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller. Who do we have today?
Hello?
Terry, calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yeah, I have a question about my neighbor's liquid amber. She has a liquid amber tree, and it just has a few leaves on it. And I was wondering, is that due to the drought? I mean, is that the reason that tree hasn't, you know, gotten any leaves on it? Or?
Well, without knowing how they're watering, what I suspect is that that tree is dying from a disease called bacterial scorch. Now, bacterial scorch occurs in a handful of different hosts in Southern California right now. It has a long history in California. This disease was first observed in grape in the 1880s, where it was known as grape mystery disease or Anaheim disease until Newton Pierce from the USDA worked on it in the late 1880s, and then it became known in grape as Pierce's disease of grape. He thought at the time that it was a virus. At the time, people really didn't know what viruses were anyway. They were just defined as something so small you couldn't filter it out of plant sap. So it was not filterable, because they didn't know much more about it than that until the advent of electron microscopes and modern scientific methods to understand what viruses were. This is not a viral disease, it is a bacterial disease. In the late 1970s, bacteria was isolated from infected plants, and it was proved that Pierce's disease is caused by the bacteria. The bacteria is called Xylella fastidiosa. Xylella because it lives in the xylem, or the water conducting tissue of a plant, or the wood of a tree is xylem, or the sapwood is the effective part that's moving the water. The middle of the tree, the xylem, no longer moves the water. But anyway, the bacteria is moved from plant to plant by sharpshooters. We have native sharpshooters, the blue-green, the redhead, the smoke tree. Now we have an introduced sharpshooter called the glassy wing sharpshooter that was introduced sometime prior to 1990. In 1990, oleanders were discovered dying out in Riverside County. Within a couple years, the oleanders were diagnosed as being infected with Xylella fastidiosa. And at the same time, that's when glassy wing sharpshooters were discovered in California. Now, it's most likely that when the sharpshooters were introduced, probably on nursery stock, and we know quite clearly that the glassy wing sharpshooters that are in California came from Texas, even though the sharpshooter is native all the way from Texas to Florida. The glassy wing sharpshooter is native from Texas to Florida. The strain or the actual insects we have in California came from Texas, and that we know that from genetics. Genetic profiles of their DNA. Most likely when those showed up, they brought a new strain to California, or they picked up strains that were already in California and introduced them into landscapes. Our native sharpshooters don't like to leave riparian areas. They mostly stay along streams. They do not do well or really infest landscaped areas like gardens, you know, suburban areas. So suddenly, oleanders started dying in 1990, and then very soon after that, liquid ambers started dying out in Riverside County, then olives started dying, plums started dying, crepe myrtles started dying. It's been known in almond for a long time as well. So most likely, that liquid amber tree is dying from scorch, bacterial scorch. Unfortunately, once the plant becomes infected, there are no treatments. It is a fatal disease, and liquid ambers are dying in large numbers throughout Southern California now, and so are olives and plums. I don't see it a lot on the crepe myrtles, but I have seen it on crepe myrtles out in Riverside County quite a bit. Not so much in LA County, but that's just a matter of time, and it may be that I'm just not seeing it and it's out there and I really haven't looked at it enough. So the bad news is that your neighbor's tree cannot be saved. It's going to die. It may be, depending on how advanced the disease is, it may die within a year, or it may take up to 5 years for them to die. The first thing you're gonna see on liquid ambers is a branch at the top of the tree will die. It'll have no leaves on it. And then the next year, you know, they're deciduous, they drop all their leaves. The next year when it grows new leaves in the spring, more of the top of the tree will not grow any leaves. That is just going to progress every year until most of the tree has no leaves, maybe just one branch on the tree has leaves on it. So I've already seen quite a few dead ones in the San Gabriel Valley. I've seen them removed in various areas. So it's common now and widespread on liquid amber and on olive, really. So that's one of the real threats to the urban forest right now, because there are so many liquid amber trees. There are many, many streets that are lined with liquid ambers throughout Southern California. We're going to see dramatic changes in the appearance of these neighborhoods when you start losing so many trees. Literally millions of trees are threatened. Now, it's not going to happen overnight. It's going to take 10, 20, maybe even 30 years before we see all those trees really die. And there may be pockets where liquid ambers don't get infected. So that's most likely what is wrong with your neighbor's tree, unless they're not watering it at all. And if that's the case, then it could be also related to drought. But most likely it is bacterial scorch.
Okay. Well, thanks for all that information. I'm going to let her know.
Yeah, let her know that what she needs to do now is probably schedule someone to remove the tree and select a new tree to be planted in its place, and to not plant another liquid amber. And I would stay away from olives. The flowering plums die rather quickly from this. Maybe it's just because they're smaller trees. They're not real big trees. But I've also, from homeowner sampling, or people bringing in samples to my laboratory, I've had Satsuma and Santa Rosa come in that were tested positive for Zyella as well. And those were dying. Those plums were dying. So it also affects the fruiting plums as well as the flowering plum. So this is really bad news for home gardeners and for anybody who cares about trees. This is a real serious problem, and there's really no way to prevent a plant from getting infected. You could treat with a systemic insecticide to try and discourage feeding on the plants, and that might buy you time, especially if you have a row of oleander that's your privacy hedge or privacy screen, and you start noticing oleanders are dying along the length of that hedge. If you treat the whole hedge with a systemic insecticide, you might slow down the progression of the disease and buy yourself some time in terms of replanting that hedge.
Okay.
Okay?
All right. Well, thank you so much. I really enjoy your show.
Okay. Well, thank you for watching, and thank you for calling in. Yes, bacterial scorch is widespread throughout Southern California, and it is killing the trees I mentioned, liquid ambers, olives, purple leaf plums, and fruiting plums as well, crepe myrtle, and oleander. Now, in oleander, you see a real progression of symptoms. It's called scorch because the edges of the leaves turn brown first. That can be mimicked in other hosts by salt damage or drought stress. So you can't be absolutely sure unless it's one of those ones I mentioned. If you see on oleander, a branch will wilt and it'll droop, and the color will go from a dark green to a grayish or a not so dark a green. The edges of the leaves will turn brown, the tips of the leaves will turn brown, and as that branch is dying, other branches start developing symptoms. And over about 3 to 5 years, then the whole bush dies. A lot of people will cut that down to the ground and it'll send up new shoots that look healthy. But within a few months, they're going to start showing symptoms as well, because the bacteria has become systemic throughout the entire plant. It is not a fast-growing bacteria in the plant. It takes time for it to grow through the whole plant. And in grape, In areas where you get hard freezes, it actually kills the bacteria in the plant. So in areas that you get down and you get snow and you probably get down into the teens, you don't get Pierce's disease of grape in areas like that. But there are some grapes that are immune, like Concord, but the wine grapes are highly susceptible. So Cabernet Sauvignon, Merlot, Pinot Noir, Syrah, Merlot, all of those are highly susceptible, although there's degrees of susceptibility. And in fact, back in 97, there was a huge outbreak of Pierce's disease down in Temecula. About 1,500 acres were killed, but they managed to bring it under control down there through a kind of an integrated approach. They gave away for free a systemic insecticide to the citrus growers, because during the winter, the glassy-winged sharpshooter would go and overwinter on citrus, which don't get infected. They're not susceptible to the strains of the bacteria we have in Southern California. And in the spring, they would come out of the citrus and get onto the grape, and they would come out by the millions. So they treated all the citrus down there, got the citrus growers, gave them the product for free. And so if you're a citrus grower, why not take it and treat your crop and protect your plants from all the insects, because these are, you know, it actually controls all insects that feed on the plant. So they really suppressed the population of glassy-winged sharpshooter. They replanted all the lost acreage. They treat the entire vineyard every spring with the systemic, it's called imidacloprid. It's sold under a variety of names, Merit, or Merit for ornamentals, Admire for ag production. And so they really stopped vine-to-vine spread. They keep the sharpshooters out of the vineyard completely by treating every spring with imidacloprid. And then also they rogue out or pull out any plants that show symptoms. The symptoms on grape are poor growth in the spring. The length of the cane, the new canes will grow, and instead of turning brown uniformly as it ages, you'll get green and brown blotches along the stem. So this delayed maturity of the epidermis on the stem leaves it green, and that'll happen in blotches. Then the leaf will fall off, but the petiole will stay on. So that's what you see in grape. And the edges of the leaves turn brown, like they're scorched or burnt. And so that's what you see in grape. The minute they see any symptoms on grape down in Temecula, down in those growing areas, they'll pull out the vine and prevent, because that's an inoculum source. If the sharpshooters can feed on that vine, then they'll move into the rest of the vineyard and spread it to the rest of the vineyard. And they've actually replanted all of their lost acreage, and they're doing quite well. So it's a real challenge when we see these diseases come up and that are epidemic proportions and really wiping out a lot of stuff. In the 1880s, when this showed up, it shut down or put out of business about 40 to 45 vineyards in the area. All their vines died. There was nothing they could do, and of course, they didn't really know what was happening. Now, I have another video on how to transplant a sago palm. And so if you have a sago palm in your garden and you're interested in moving it, you can move them. They move about as easily as palm trees move. Palm trees are also fairly easy to move in terms of their survival, but they're heavy and they're big. So in that aspect, they're hard to move because they're big, heavy plants. They're very, very heavy, in fact. And if you're moving a large palm, you're gonna need a crane. You can't do it on your own. But a small palm, you know, with a wheelbarrow and maybe a large dolly, you could probably move it, and a couple of big beefy guys to help you move it around. So let's take a look at this video on transplanting a sago palm and see how they do it. So it'll give you an idea how you might move your own sago palm if you've got one you want to move around. Or if you're buying a large one, this will also give you some clues on how to plant it. Let's take a look at this video.
This is a little bit of a dare. We never like to see plant material wasted, so if we can rescue a plant, we try. This landscape is going to be transformed and changed and redeveloped. We have a cycad, been here quite a while on site, and we're going to try to relocate it. We're usually against transplanting and relocating plants, but this is either relocated or it will be destroyed. So we're going to give it a try and see what we can do. The first step we're going to perform is to remove probably at least 25% of the fronds, focusing the plant's energy into a more manageable canopy, reduce the vascular demands on the tree's system, and see if we can relocate it, get it in the ground, and get it to survive. Okay. We want to soften the ground here to make excavation easier. So we're going to do an initial prep here. We're going to do some partial excavation. And once we get a nice water catchment around the tree where the spot is fairly level, we'll be able to fill it up with water and soften the soil. Pretty dry. This could give us an advantage in the move. We'll make clean cuts to the roots that we have to cut. Of course, we're going to have to cut roots. This plant has an extensive root system. Once we've made our initial dig, we'll recut the splintered and shattered root ends to clean cuts, and this will help the roots to resprout. Five or ten pups are going to come off of this plant in the process of translocating it. We've popped another little pup off the side of this cycad here, and we've got some roots with it, and we're going to go ahead and pop this one up too, see if we can do another rescue out of this. We're going to give our new pup something to eat. We've got some readily available nutrients here in this grow mulch, and we're just going to try to create a good environment for roots to resprout. We're mixing it with the parent soil, the material that the plant has grown in for all these decades, and so hopefully no shock to the system. We'll give it the same thing that it had with a little nutrients and see if we can get it to take. Underneath the plant, our topsoil is less than a foot. Below that, we have our D&G, and it's like concrete. It is not yielding very easily, and so we're going to go ahead and I'm going to fill the basin all the way around it and just try to soften it with water. We'll take our lunch break. We'll come back and tackle it again and see if we can get this thing out of the ground. So we've got about 4 feet across here. This should be enough. We've excavated our hole for the cycad. We're moving a sago palm today, and we've prepped a site for it in advance of excavation. So we're going to go back over there and see if we can collect it. We have managed to loosen it. So now it's a question of getting it out of this hole and onto the truck. Yeah, it looks like it's completely free. Because if there were roots in the center holding it, we wouldn't be able to push it up. All of the roots appear to be lateral. It's sitting right on top of the ground. We're going to start with the tarp. Even this would just protect our hands from the rough trunk. We're going to cush the trunk like this. Good. We were very fortunate that it was rooted on a site with only a foot of soil all around it. And so it was sitting on D&G, which it did not root into. When we trimmed all the peripheral roots, we were able to rock it out of the hole. We rocked it back and forth, filling back in the hole underneath it, bringing it up to the surface. Then we were able to drag it on a kind of a skid arrangement and get it out to the truck. When you move a cycad, dig the hole where it's going first. You want to prep your hole first and minimum time out of the ground. So we got her up and the root ball tarped, got her on the truck. So we're heading right to the planting site, only a few miles away, and we're going to go into the ground with it. We've backed in. It's only out of the ground for half an hour or an hour. This was a Herculean effort. It took four of us. Four of us could not lift this, but four of us could drag it. We're going to go ahead and plant it right here where it stands. We've prepared our hole in advance to minimize the stress on it. We're using water. We're blasting down here at the root ball. We're making sure we're trying to flush water and soil into all the voids. We want to make sure we have no voids or air pockets under the root ball. So we're getting it pretty soggy right now. We're wetting it down and flushing the soil into any possible voids. And then we're going to do some soil compaction around the edges here outside the root ball. We're going to do a little soil compression, try to drive the air out, make sure that we don't have any pockets of air underneath. We're going to go ahead and just rock it back and forth in the soggy, wet soil here while it's wetted down and try to get our final position for the tree's placement. It's a huge success. Now it's just whether or not it survives. We're going to come back on this. We're going to keep a weather eye on it. This is a gentler site than it was in. It was in full sun. On this side, it's in mottled shade, a little more protection from the sun, maybe not as much stress on the plant. So hopefully we'll have an easy transition to a survivor and a long-term specimen on site here.
So you can see that it's a lot of hard work to move a heavy plant like that. That's the real challenge, is actually lifting something. You know, if it were any bigger, you'd need a crane. It probably weighs in excess of 500 pounds, maybe even more than that, significantly more than that. So the big challenge is actually picking them up and moving them. If you're just moving a small shrub, an azalea or a small camellia, you know, it's not that heavy. But those sago palms and palm trees are very heavy. Now, the question is it worth the effort and the money you're going to have to pay a crew to move a plant? Well, with a sago palm like that, the answer is almost definitely yes. A plant that size would run you $1,000 to $2,000 to purchase, and maybe even more. That was multi-trunked. The trunks were fairly long. And if you go to a large specimen nursery and try and get that, you're going to pay a lot of money for it. They grow very slowly. And so slow plants, buying big plants that are slow growers, you pay a lot of money for them. The other thing is that they are actually quite successfully moved. It's not, you know, they usually take quite well. Sagos will also take a lot of shade. So going from the full sun to the shade is not a problem for that plant. Now there's a couple things I would have done a little differently that they did in the video. One is that when they had that pup or that offshoot, I would not have mixed any of the soil from the area into the pot. Bulk soil or just soil from your garden in pots doesn't work well. It usually shrinks away from the edge of the pot. And then when you try and water, the water runs down the edge and doesn't soak the root ball. So you need something that's not going to do that. Now, he mixed a little grow mulch with the soil. And so, you know, he'll probably get away with that. The plant will grow. But I would always use a bagged potting soil, as opposed to digging up soil from the ground and potting things. And I don't know that I would have used a 5-gallon pot to pot it in. I would probably pot it in a 1-gallon pot. A lot of times people will also cut off all the fronds except the tender, newest growth. People also tell me that when you move a sago palm, that you get your best results if you move it right before it's going to grow its new leaves. So if it's growing new growth, if the new growth is up, that big cluster of new leaves coming up, and it's actively growing the new leaves, that's not a good time to try and move them. You want to let those come up, mature, and then dig it and move it. Sometime you kind of have to predict when you expect that new growth to start. They usually start in the spring. So, but they actually move fairly easily, especially if you give them a little extra water over the next 6 to 12 months. You're going to want to water them, you know, once a week or every other week in the spring and the fall, and maybe once a month in the winter. We get good rain, they'll be fine. You don't need to water. But in the summer, I would continue to water once a week. And then after they've been in the ground a couple of years, you can really back off once they start get established. I've seen sago palms that had no leaves on them that I thought were dead throw out new leaves and take off and grow again. So they're pretty tough in terms of coming back once you get good care. So let's take a look now at, we looked at Micropsychus, and the next one we want to look at, actually I'll just mention Chiguilla. There are two species in Colombia in the genus Chiguilla that's in the Zamiaceae. And they are from northwestern Colombia. They were described in 1990, so they are fairly new to the botanical world. Both species are listed as critically endangered. And, you know, a lot of these, I think all these cycads we're talking about are considered endangered because they've been over-collected or they've lost of habitat. So when Marie says you're actually helping to, you know, keep these rare species alive, it's true if you're buying one of the really rare ones. Not so much for Cycas revoluta. You can see those on almost every block nowadays. The other genus I want to talk about is Zamia. There's about 65 species of Zamia in the New World from Georgia, USA, south to Bolivia. If we bring up this picture full screen, this is Zamia furfuraceae. I've got one of these at home. Like I said, they're native to North, Central, and South America. Species occur as far north as Georgia in the United States, which is Zamia integrifolia. The only cycad native to the United States as far south as Bolivia, which is Zamia boliviana. The type species is Zamia pumila, and which there's also Zamia furfuraceae. Now, if we take a look at our next picture, this is 32. This is Zamia furfuraceae. Bring it up just to show you the cones. bring this up full screen. This is Zamia furfuraceae. I really like Zamia furfuraceae. They only get about 3 to 4 feet tall. Maybe they get bigger in the wild or if they get really old, but I've never seen them much bigger than that. And if you grow them in full sun, they'll have much more dense or tightly spaced leaflets. And if you grow them in the shade, you'll get spaces between here. But cycads in general will tolerate quite a bit of shade. So how do you identify a cycad? Well, of course, they have cylindrical trunks, which usually do not branch, but actually I've seen Cycas revolutas that do. Leaves grow directly from the trunk, typically fall when older, leaving a crown of leaves at the top. The leaves grow in a rosette form with new foliage emerging from the top and the center of the crown. The leaves are pinnate, which means that you have just right behind me, these are pinnate. You have a rachis or a stem, a central stem, and then the leaflets come off, just one set of leaflets. Bowinia can be bipinnate. They're either compound leaflets emerging as ribs or have edges or margins that are so deeply cut to appear compound. Some species have leaves that are bipinnate, and that's the Bowinia, which means that the leaflets each have their own subleaflets. Three families can be identified by looking at the central stalk of the leaf. Each family has at least one vein running up the leaf from bottom to top, longitudinally. In the Cycadaceae, there's only one vein in the center of the leaf stalk. In the Stanguraceae, there is also only one central vein, but there are also lateral veins. And in the Zamiaceae, there are more than one central vein, and they are parallel to each other. Now, we can also talk a little bit about the conservation of cycads. Their numbers have been dwindling, and they face extinction because of theft and for a collection from the wild, as well as habitat destruction. About 23% of the 305 cycad species are either critically endangered or endangered, and 15% are considered vulnerable. Zamia in the New World, Cycas in Asia, and Cephalartos in Africa are the most threatened genera. At least two species, Encephalosus woodyi and Encephalartos reliculus, both from Africa, are confirmed extinct in the wild. So only forms grown in botanical gardens or in gardens are known for those two species. Cycads are long-lived with infrequent reproduction, and most populations are small, putting them at risk of extinction from habitat destruction and cataclysmic environmental events. And I'd imagine some of the changes in the environment that we're experiencing worldwide will also threaten them. Now, there is an excellent collection of cycads up in Santa Barbara at Lotus Land, and let's go to this video clip showing a lot of the cycads that are in Lotus Land. I've used this video clip before, but we weren't really talking about cycads. So let's take a look at this video clip from Lotus Land showing their cycads to give you another look at a wide variety of cycads.
We're here today at Ganawaska Lotus Land in Santa Barbara, California. Virginia Hayes shows us this spectacular garden. Virginia, how did this garden become established and what's its purpose?
Well, we're here basically because Ganawaska, who created most of what you see around us, decided to grow a garden and then leave it for the rest of us to enjoy. There's an older history here. It was a nursery for a number of years in the 1880s, and then it was just a private estate. But Ganawaska owned it for over 40 years and created the gardens that we're going to see today.
I see a beautiful water feature here.
Yes, this pond was actually here in the 1920s, but Madam Walska did her particular touch to things, which was to dramatize everything and added all the shell features.
And around it, we've got plants which don't use a lot of water. We see aloes here.
That's right. This is the aloe garden.
And these aloes are from what part of the world? They're not from this part?
Most aloes are from South Africa and a few from Madagascar and other parts of Africa. Our collection is mainly from South Africa with a few Madagascans.
It's really dramatic. I like this one. It looks like a tongue.
Yes, this is called Aloe plicatilis. If you look at the way the leaves fold together, it's sort of like a braid.
Ah, okay. And then everyone's familiar with the aloe vera.
That's right.
And you've got some of that here.
We do have that, not right where we are, but the interesting thing is that most of these succulent aloes have the same medicinal properties that aloe vera is famed for.
I didn't know that.
They are not hardy, probably below 20 degrees. They may survive a few hours in the 20s, but we're essentially frost-free here.
So much of the Southwest can actually grow these then. I've seen them in Phoenix and Tucson.
Mm-hmm.
But we get into the higher desert, it's going to get too cold, so they're houseplants there.
Right.
Good medicinal houseplants.
That's right.
There's another tall one right there.
Yes. This is Aloe spectabilis.
That's beautiful.
And it is spectacular.
It is. They're trees.
Exactly. And they get much larger, actually, in their native habitats than they would here.
And these I like. They're nice mound formers. They're kind of nice green here.
Aloe brevifolia.
Oh, that's spectacular. And I understand you've got a world-famous garden with other plants in it here as well.
That's right. We have an amazing cycad collection.
That's something we ought to see.
Okay.
Cycad. Now, the sago palm is a cycad, but it's really not a palm, is it?
Right. It's one of the 10 or 11 genera in the cycad family that... They look like palms a little bit.
A little bit. Over here we've got fan palms, but I've seen a lot of palms that look like these cycads.
Right.
And so it's easy to see that they're confused. And I say they've got cones on them.
Right. They don't have flowers. They evolved long before flowers came on the scene.
So they're more like a pine tree.
Exactly.
Than a palm.
Exactly. The interesting thing about them is that they have male cones on male plants and female cones on female plants.
Okay.
And normally where they grow... The pollination to produce seeds on those female cones would be done by little insects.
And this is really here as a scientific collection now, isn't it?
Well, it started, of course, as one of Madame's collections just for visual impact, which it certainly has.
It does.
But because she was able to get these plants so many years ago in the 60s and 70s, she was able to amass a pretty impressive collection of all the genera that grow throughout the world.
We just moved into a bunch of blue ones.
Yes. These are adapted for desert climates in Africa and show off that blue coloration that's often seen in those kind of plants.
And over the other side is really green but tall.
Yes. A lot of these actually grow in sort of understory of a forest. Mm-hmm. And this one grew in South Africa in the forests and is now extinct in the wild. These are some of the offspring of the last plants that were removed over 100 years ago.
That's part of your scientific work then, to actually propagate these and hopefully preserve the germplasm.
Exactly. These, unfortunately, are all male. We don't have females of that species.
So you can't do, and you have to hand pollinate, don't you?
Right, right.
Look at the cone on that. That's spectacular.
Yes.
You've only showed us two of the many fabulous gardens here, but they're spectacular. Thank you.
You're very
welcome. I'm back. So that's a nice little clip. I used that clip before when we talked about aloes. And you know, if you're thinking about getting rid of really high water use gardens, you know, the aloes, the cycads, the agaves, euphorbias, I haven't talked a lot about euphorbias, but those are excellent plant materials to replace, you know, lawns particularly, because nothing's gonna use more water than your lawn. In a garden, pools use less water than a lawn. A lot of people think pools use a lot of water. But if you think about how many square feet of lawn we have across Southern California compared to how many square feet of pool, it's probably about 10-to-1 ratio. Every front yard for every block from San Francisco to San Diego has a front lawn almost. And not everyone has a pool, but people always have lawns. And the lawn uses more water per square foot than a pool does anyway. So you can cover your pool and reduce the water loss by evaporation. But anyway, all these plants we've been talking about are the kind of plants you can put in your garden. You can get them established. Currently, we don't have a lot of problems with these types of plant materials. We talked about scorch being a problem on some of our trees. We've got some other problems on other kinds of plants. But for the most part, we don't have a lot of diseases or pests that are decimating these. There is, for agave, there's an agave weevil, which is becoming a big problem. But aloes, well, some of them get the aloe mite, but most of them don't get the aloe mite. So these are excellent plant materials for Southern California, converting your garden from a high water use garden with a lot of grass to a low water use garden with no grass, just drought tolerant ground covers, ice plants, and then your foundation plants are gonna be things like aloes, agaves, euphorbias, and the different cycads. So those are really excellent. Now, we had our mystery object, and so I often forget to tell you what it is. So let's take a look at it again, and I'll tell you what this is. Let's go to our overhead, and why you probably might want to order one of these and put it in your backyard. Because you can buy them. You can order them from different garden catalogs. So you get a good look at it here. This is an egg mass from a praying mantis. And at some point in time, in the next month or two, maybe it won't even pop until if I put it outside and it got cold, it'll just sit there for until the spring. But if you keep it indoors and it's warm, what'll happen is one day, probably several hundred, maybe even as many as 500, little tiny praying mantises, about this big, just tiny little things, will come running out of here, and they're gonna start eating each other. And years ago, I had an egg mass that came in to my lab. This was sent in by a homeowner. She didn't know what it was. She took it off the branch. They're usually secreted onto. Of course, when they're created, they're soft. Then they harden up. But she found it. She pried it off the branch, and so you can find them on the branches of fruit trees or any kind of shrub. And she pried it off, sent it in, said, "What the heck is that?" I've seen these for sale at various farmers markets where they're selling things like ladybug beetles, or maybe they're selling adult praying mantis. It may be one of our native praying mantis, or it might be the really big Chinese praying mantis, which is quite large and very common now in gardens in Southern California. And so they're really fun to have in your garden. And so what I did when I had one of these a long time ago is they all started to come out, and there were a lot of them in a big jar. So I reached in and plucked out one at a time and put them in little jars. And then I started raising Drosophila fruit flies, these little tiny, what's called vinegar flies. You'll see them in your kitchen landing on fruit like bananas or oranges. And what Drosophila really do is they eat yeast, or they'll eat fungi. And so they're getting on your fruit because they're eating the yeast on the outside of the fruit. And a lot of times, you'll get a lot of them in your kitchen, and you'll walk by and they're flying around, and they're called vinegar flies. So I was feeding them to these little ones, and I had about 80 jars, and I kept putting in the little fruit flies. But my mortality rate was about 90%. One day I came home, one day I had 90. Within a week, I had 40. Within another few days, I was down to about 10. So they even though a lot of them come out of here, most of them aren't going to survive. And that's kind of a strategy for insects in general, is they have lots and lots of babies with the hope that maybe 1%, 5% survive to adulthood. Just like spiders do that. They have an egg sac. Hundreds come out. Most of them don't survive. So what's better to do if you get one of these and if you have small children and you want to, show them something that's really fun about nature, let them hatch and you'll leave them in the jar. They're going to eat each other. And after a few days, there'll only be about 10 of them left. And so they're going to get a lot of nutrition. They're going to, eat a lot. And then you want to just let them go in the yard. The other thing you can do is just put it out in your yard and let them hatch out in the garden. Now, I just make a comment. This isn't going to really bring under control a disease, an insect infestation in your garden. Say you have citrus and you get whitefly or mealybug or scale or something like that on the tree. Now, these won't eat scale anyway, but, praying mantises aren't going to be eating scale insects. But they'll eat small flies. They'll eat anything that walks in front of them. Praying mantis don't hunt. They stand still. And they're green and they look like a twig, and they're just standing there on a twig, and if something goes by them, they grab it and eat it. And I've had adults, praying mantis brought into the lab as well, and I've kept those in large cages, and then I go out with a sweep net over a lawn and catch small flies and put it in the cage and watch them feed. It's just something that's kind of fun to do. I showed it to my two sons, and they thought it was really cool for all of about 30 seconds. And then off they were to go play soccer. But I thought they'd really be a little more interested than that. So this is a praying mantis egg sac or egg mass. And you can order these from various catalogs, or sometimes you'll find them for sale. And it'd be a nice little science project, maybe for an elementary school age child to let them hatch out, make some observations, try and rear them maybe with some Drosophila fruit flies. So that's what that is. Now, next week, we're going to be talking about bromeliads and begonias. And I just want to maybe show you a few things about bromeliads right now. So maybe we could bring up some pictures of bromeliads behind me. I may not get in too deeply into the various genera of bromeliads, but let me tell you about bromeliads. Bromeliads are in the family Bromeliaceae. The one you see behind me is Bilbergia. This is Bilbergia, and Bilbergia is a genus. They have cups, and they're epiphytes. They grow in forests, usually in tropical forests, in the branches of trees, and they have these cups. And as long as you keep water in the cup, they do fine. So they're actually very, even though they're very tropical, they're not high water use. You just put a little water in the cup, and you can tie them onto branches. You can tie them onto the trunks of trees. You can grow them on a slab of wood. And they throw pups off the base. So you'll have this one, you know, with all these long strap-like leaves and a cup right in the middle, and you water them, and just by keeping water in the cup. And the stem can come down and be tied onto something. Or you can grow them in a pot with soil, and they'll root. And the genus or the family, the Bromeliaceae, also includes the air plants, and the genus has just dropped out of my Tillandsias, and they're fun to grow too, although they have to be misted fairly frequently, either daily or every other day. Bromeliads do quite well. You need to grow them a little bit in the shade. They'll take morning sun, but they're going to need afternoon shade, especially in hot inland valleys. Down at the beach, you might be able to get away with them in the full sun all day. So you can see how pretty the flowers are. And there's two things about the flowers. So this one, now bromeliads are mostly hummingbird pollinated. So they're good hummingbird attractors. And the hummingbirds are attracted to the red flower. So the tall ones, you know, like Bilbergia, like the one you see in front of you right now, we'll have this tall inflorescence, and each one of these is a flower right here. Each one is a flower, and they got these blue stamens and red petals. And the ones that have a flower that sticks way up, so you've got these strap leaves like this, and the cup here, and then you have this long flower spike like this one here, and this will be red. Now, let's go through a few more pictures and take a look at a few more of them. Just bring them up and we'll talk about bromeliads a little bit. Here's another. This is also in the genus Bilbergia, a different species. And let's move on. You can see the typical, and I don't recall the name of this one, but if we just move along, maybe we'll get to one of the Neo-Regilias. But this is just a little sampling of bromeliads. You can grow them because they have really colorful foliage, or you can grow them for their very colorful flowers. They can be tender, so you have to be careful not to expose them to really cold, freezing nights, or you'll lose them. So if you have them in pots or tied onto something, you can bring them indoors during the coldest winter months, and they'll do fine. But there's, like I said, there's two kinds. There's those that have the long flower spike that's pink. Then there's some that'll flower deep down in the throat, in the bowl. And in that case, the foliage turns red in order to attract the hummingbirds. Let's go through a few more pictures and see what if we can. This one is a really favorite. You're going to see this one, and it's and I've forgotten the genus now. But you see these almost in every grocery store nowadays, Vons and Ralph's or any grocery store, and these are really common. There's some big growers in Southern California, particularly Kent bromeliads down in San Diego, one of the biggest growers in the United States, maybe in the world. And this is Acmea, they have the pink inflorescence and the blue flowers. Let's go on to some more flowers and just take a look at a little show. This is also Acmea, another one. And what they do is after they bloom, that plant is going to not bloom again. They're monocarpic in that sense, but they'll send off pups below or new plants from the base. And you can let them grow up, get to, you can either let them turn into clumps or you can break them off and pot them individually. So once you get one bromeliad, you pretty much have it because you can keep growing the pups. I've had some that don't want a pup for me, and I've got quite a few now. Let's keep going through these pictures and take a look. And some of the bromeliads are actually quite large. Look at this inflorescence here. So some of them are actually very large plants, as you know, 2 or 3 feet across and 3 or 4 feet large. You often think of bromeliads as being smaller plants, but some of them are quite large. Let's keep going and take a look at a few more pictures. And this is Guzmania, and Guzmania is a really popular genus. But you notice the whole inflorescence is pink. But I want to get to one of the ones that doesn't flower with such a tall spike. Let's keep moving and go through and take a look. Here we go. We've got one where the inflorescence, this is another Guzmania, I'm sorry. This is also Guzmania. We're just looking down on the inflorescence. So let's take a look at another picture. And this is from one of the nurseries where they grow these. They grow these in large nurseries, particularly down in San Diego County. Kent Bromeliads has enormous greenhouses where they grow tens of thousands of these. They're all grown from tissue culture, so they're all genetically identical. They're clones. Let's take a look at some more pictures. Another Guzmania. Let's keep moving. More Guzmania. They come in every color you can think of. Yellows, reds, oranges, no blues. This is, boy, you've got me on the genus on this one. I should know it. It's another bromeliad, but let's move on and we'll talk about it next week. And I'll remember this in a minute. Let's move on to the next. These are all bromeliads. And you notice the ones with the long spikes like this are pink. Let's move on, and I wanted to show you what I mean by the, here's more of the same genus. More of the same genus. And these are Tillandsias. And this is, you know, where they're all tied on. This is the Tillandsia that's native to the southern United States. It's called Spanish moss. Let's move on to the next picture. See if we can find it. And in their native habitats, they'll grow on anything. They'll grow on telephone wires, on rocks. Next picture. We have one more picture. And this is another one that is interesting. But let's move on to the next picture. Let's just run through these pictures real quick. I'm hoping we'll get to Neo-Rigelia. Because that in the Neo-Rigelia, the flowers are down inside the cup, and the leaves turn red. And so they're really striking, and they're often striped. So anyway, we're going to talk more about bromeliads next week. We're going to look at those same pictures again and talk about them more in depth. And we're going to talk about begonias, too, because begonias are a big genus and do well in Southern California. Now, begonias are a little more water they need more water. But anyways, our time's up for today. We'll be back next Sunday with another episode of Gardens of California. I want to thank our crew in the control room for all the hard work putting on the show, and thank everyone who watched the show and people who called in today. And until I see you next week, happy gardening.